You may have seen ancient maps like this, or this, with a strange landmass in the southern hemisphere. That is what we call Terra Australis, or any fancy iteration of the name, coming from Latin, meaning the land of the south. This mythical continent sprouted from the belief that the lands of the world must be balanced between the southern and northern hemispheres, and, in this video, I'll be exploring the evolution of this theory from its conception in ancient Greece to its inevitable debunking in the Age of Exploration. To begin this section, we need to establish the Greeks' understanding of what the world looked like at the time. Basically, there is no sub-Saharan Africa, no Scandinavia or Oceania. China barely exists in its full extent, simply being a straight shot northwards from India, which, in most cases, is the most eastern edge of the map. This map was divided between three continents: Libya, which is the African portion, Asia, and Europe. Now that we have that established, we can begin. But our myth of Terra Australis doesn't even begin with the myth. It begins with Plato's Socratic dialogues on Atlantis. In these dialogues, Plato describes a land beyond the Strait of Gibraltar. This land was apparently larger than both Libya and Asia combined, and before the time of Plato, men from this land began conquering both Asia and Europe. The continent of Atlantis was described to have a northern mountainous region, and the rest was flat plains, with one mountain in the middle of these plains. The territory was divided around among 10 different rulers, but due to an earthquake, Atlantis sank to the bottom of the Atlantic Ocean, leaving nothing but a muddy shoal restricting sailing expeditions. The next man to theorize on Terra Australis was Aristotle. In part 5 of his book series of meteorology, Aristotle describes the limitations of human settlement when he states, "But it is the sea which divides, as it seems, the parts beyond India from those beyond the pillars of Heracles, and prevents the earth from being inhabited all round." Now, since there must be a region bearing the same relation to the southern pole as the place we live in bears to our pole, it will clearly correspond in the ordering of its winds, as well as in other things. This suggests Aristotle's belief that there is a land beyond the seas, past the territories known to him, past India and past Europe. And the only reason that humans hadn't found it yet was because the limitations of the ocean. Aristotle goes on to introduce the theory of symmetry to the myth, with the symmetry of winds in the northern and southern hemispheres. The Roman geographer Pomponius Mela, in his work De Stiu Orbis, meaning description of the world, divided the world into 5 zones, only 2 of which were habitable by humans: the northern temperate and the southern temperate zones. The reason by that time the people of the 2 zones hadn't interacted was because the space in between was too hot for humans to bear. But the description of the world Mela gave in his works was purely conjectural, basing nothing in science. And the description that was accurate was from part of the world that he had seen himself. And even with all of these horrible scientific practices, his work managed to be spread in the future throughout the medieval world, inspiring many authors and instilling the idea of Terra Australis in future generations. The next prominent view of the world comes from Ptolemy, who wrote 8 volumes on geography. In the 7th volume, he describes the Indian Ocean as being entirely enclosed by land, like the Mediterranean Ocean is. This land would connect from the Horn of Africa to Indochina, which would make the Indian Ocean the largest enclosed sea on Earth. Although, Ptolemy made assumptions on the southern half of the Indian Ocean, and he never even attempts to explain what lies past the Atlantic Ocean or the easternmost Chinese provinces. His inaccuracy is theorized to be because Ptolemy was basing his knowledge of the parts of the world that he had never been to with accounts from people who had been there, or who knew someone that had went there. These word-of-mouth accounts most likely had been exaggerated for entertainment value, and thus affected the accuracy of the maps and description of the world by the geographer. No prominent geographers really appeared for many years, as Europe fell into the Dark Ages. This saw a period of mass war, and the theory of Terra Australis hitting the wayside, as trying not to die of the plague or starving to death was more important than exploring and theorizing the world. The Dark Ages roughly ended around the time when the printing press was created, which allowed for easy access to literature and the expansion of the mind. Peasants now could have other opinions than what they've been told is true for years. Among the literature to be reprinted with the printing press were many works by ancient authors on geography, which reignited the idea of Terra Australis that had been previously lost to time. The true size of the Earth was debated for many years, but as the New World was discovered by Europeans, the size of our planet was cemented. And the next man to change the idea of Terra Australis was Bartolomeu Diaz, when he sailed down the coast of Africa, reaching the Cape of Good Hope and establishing trade with Asia. Unknown to Diaz, he pushed the mythical lands further south and east, proving to the world that the Indian Ocean was not enclosed, but open to the world's seas. Abel Tasman, the first European to sight New Zealand, assumed that the islands were a peninsula of Terra Australis, and would add this to the changing understanding of the ever-mysterious land. The next and probably most influential published work would be by the famous Mercator, father of the commonly used Mercator projection map. His most popular map, published in 1569, depicted South America as attached to a massive landmass to the south. This land would cross the bottom of the map and extend northward to become what was understood at the time to be part of Australia. At the same time, a man by the name of Alexander Dalrymple, a proponent of the Terra Australis theory, published many charts depicting the world with a massive continent, and would defend the idea tooth and nail. Inspired by Dalrymple's works, James Cook set off on his first voyage, under the guise of a mission to track the path of Venus in the sky. On this mission, Cook very accurately mapped the coastline of New Zealand, debunking the myth Abel Tasman had begun, with the archipelago being a peninsula of Terra Australis. When Cook returned with his knowledge, Alexander Dalrymple wasn't discouraged in his belief of the theory, as Australia still existed, and there was no proof that the southern coast wasn't attached to this mysterious land. There was so much proof suggesting that Terra Australis didn't exist, but people still held onto this belief. So, James Cook's second voyage was specifically to find out whether or not this land existed. As Cook sailed below the Cape of Good Hope, he went directly east, sailing below the southern coast of Australia, bringing the idea of Terra Australis to an end. He determined that any land further south would be too cold to be inhabited by human. The final resting point for the theory came with the book A Voyage to Terra Australis, written by Matthew Flinders. This was a book written on his circumnavigation of Australia, giving an accurate description of the southern coastline. Since Cook had only sailed south of Australia, he never mapped the southern coast. So, this expedition finally showed the true size of Australia. And, in his book, Matthew saw the importance of the idea of Terra Australis. So, he gave the land the name of Australia. Australia in Latin, meaning land of the south.